Okay, that was really good. Let's go back to verse 2, because we have, yeah, these R's in verse 2. Could we do them with a bit more weight, but still have like some sort of lightness and airiness to them? But do them quietly, but not too quiet. And you were doing them sort of like, oh, but instead of that, could you do it more like, oh? Okay?
Our arrangement's finished, printed, and ready for a rehearsal. However, this doesn't necessarily mean that things can't be changed further if you find that there are issues that need to be addressed. Don't worry, this is completely common and doesn't mean you've done a bad job. So, let's look at a few things you need to watch out for while the arrangement's being rehearsed and how you might fix them, either then and there, or with a revision of the parts later. Remember, the earlier you spot and fix potential issues, the easier it'll be for your singers to relearn their parts and not have an earlier version stuck in their muscle memory. There are countless ways of teaching an arrangement to a group of singers, and I won't really go into these in this video. However, if you're interested in learning more about this, leave me a comment and I'll look into it in a future video. Whether you're teaching the arrangement yourself or not, however, you need to listen closely to how your singers respond to the parts they're singing, and know the difference between a problem that the singers might have because of their ability, or because of the arrangement itself. I recommend that you make notes while you're rehearsing, and that you take a recording of your singers when they sing through the arrangement at the end of the rehearsal. Your mind may be hyper-focused on the rehearsal while you're there, but it can be tricky to remember afterwards what was working and what wasn't. You can make notes directly on your sheet if you're using notated scores, or in a notebook if you're teaching by ear. Most mobile phones have simple recording software built in these days, so you can put yours in front of the singers while they're singing, and you'll be able to listen to your arrangement with fresh ears at a later time. Oh, and don't just write down what's not working. If a particular part of the song is sounding great, make a note of that as well, as you'll be able to reapply the same arranging methods for a different arrangement and be certain that it'll sound good. Anyway, let's look at a few potential issues and how to solve them. A common problem that pops up with notated pop music arrangements is that the rhythms can be quite complicated, and standard notation doesn't always help with making them clearer. This is an instance where it's important to break up the music into rhythm and pitch. Have the singers say the rhythm in time a few times, and then add the pitch later, and they should be able to learn the part. This is a normal limitation of notated music, so don't worry too much about it if you find that you've notated a rhythm incorrectly, but do address it as soon as possible. Another common problem is misjudging the ranges or abilities of the singers, particularly expecting them to be able to sing something that is quite difficult, and finding that they can't. This will probably require a reworking of the section where it occurs, so I recommend leaving that section of the song out of your rehearsal and fixing it afterwards. You may be able to correct it then and there somewhat, but changing one part will often have implications on the other parts. So it's better, in my opinion, to sit down with it outside of the potentially stressful rehearsal situation. One exception to this problem might be if you've got either the soprano or tenor section singing a high note above the other singers, and you find that it sounds out of tune when sung by all the singers in a section. A quick fix to this is to have the note sung as a solo by a singer that you know to be strong. Because it's a high note in the singer's range, it will naturally ring out stronger due to the added overtones of singing in a high range. Therefore, you may find that a single singer will sound good and balanced against the other sections in this particular case. Sometimes, you'll discover a place in the song where there's something dissonant happening which you weren't expecting. Of course, this can happen due to some of the singers in a section singing flat or sharp, but it can also be a result of your arrangement. Semitone dissonances between sections can sound thrilling when done right, but they can be tricky to get in tune, especially for lower ability singers. There's also a chance that a dissonant interval, like a minor ninth, or a suspended fourth against the major third, has snuck in. And these often run the risk of sounding like mistakes, or confusing the singers. These kinds of problems can vary in severity, and usually happen because it's difficult to keep track of what multiple sections are doing at the same time. Usually, you just have to move one part to a different note to resolve them, but especially if you're stressed from trying to figure out what is wrong, it might be better to leave this section of the song for now and figure it out in your own time. Of course, I don't mean to say that you shouldn't use dissonant intervals, as they're very useful for creating tension and release in the song. However, you need to make sure that you use them with purpose, and that you use them in such a way that the singers can do them justice. There's of course also a possibility that a section of the song doesn't sound like you imagined it in your mind when arranging it, and you're not happy with it. For instance, you might have imagined a building section, where the parts are supposed to get louder and louder, but find that in practice it doesn't sound as exciting as you imagined that it would be. Or an instrumental solo that you transcribed for your arrangement might not work like you wanted it to when sung by voices. You'll have to ask yourself whether you can change the section to get it working, or if it's best to remove it altogether. For building sections, the key to getting a steady increase in volume and intensity is to have the voices start low in the range and progressively get higher as they get louder. So you can certainly change what you have in this way to get a better result, though it's probably best to do it outside of the rehearsal. For instrumental sections that aren't working, chances are you can take them out of the arrangement entirely, or change them into something else if you really need to have a transitional section. You can get away with much shorter arrangements in a cappella music than you can in instrumental music, so don't be afraid to trim away the fat if necessary. Above all, however, be patient with your singers, as it may take a while for them to get to grips with your arrangement. If it doesn't sound exactly as you wanted to from the start, you probably need some more time to rehearse it. It also takes a while for singers to engage their muscle memory, and you'll find that the arrangement will sound better and better the more you rehearse and perform it. Also, don't forget to make notes of any changes you make to the arrangement for the future. Remember that your current group will take on your changes and feedback now, but if there's a bit of a turnover, you may find that the new singers will face the same struggles as the senior ones did earlier. And you don't want to have to troubleshoot the same arrangement over and over.
And there you have it, the process of doing an arrangement from start to finish. I realise that I've only done a basic overview and glossed over a few topics. However, I'm going to be looking at more specific topics in detail going forward. So if there's anything you're wondering about, leave me a comment and I might explore it in a future video. For now, to celebrate that we got to the end of the first series of Choir with Knut, the next episode will be a performance of the final arrangement of Leave a Light On. I hope you'll enjoy it, and I'll see you again soon.